Good morning, everyone. My name is David Lejean, and I'm going to be talking to you about extractive distillation for separating ethanol and water systems. So ethanol and water form what's called an azeotrope. And when you have an azeotropic mixture and you try and boil it, you end up with a vapor phase that has exactly the same composition as the liquid phase you started with. So this is basically the maximum purity you can get through regular distillation, which applies heat to try and boil off a more volatile component, in this case ethanol. We'll get more of that in the gas phase. Now, unfortunately, the azeotropic ethanol and water form comes at about 90 mole percent ethanol and 10 mole percent water. But for ethanol to be useful as a fuel, we need it much more pure than that. It has to be roughly 98.7 mole percent purity. And to get there, regular distillation isn't going to work. So that's where we use extractive methods. So the main difference between extractive distillation and regular distillation is its use of a mass separating agent. So it has all the same energy separating agents. You use heat, of course, to boil off more volatile. But then you also add a solvent feed above your azeotrope feed. And that solvent is selected to modify the activity coefficients of the other two components when they're in its presence. And what that'll do is it'll actually shift your azeotrope composition from, say, 90-10 to excess of 99-1. So now the desired purity that you want is within your azeotropic limit, and you can proceed through regular distillation in that column, the extractive column, to get your fuel good ethanol. Of course, this does come with quite a few costs. These costs, just so you know, they've been designed for a column that produces roughly 70 million gallons per year, worth around 140 million. Now, at the start, we have the utility and maintenance costs. These are typical of any column, extractive or not. And that's roughly $4,700 per day. Next, we have the solvent cost, which is specific to extractive distillation. And if we're using glycerol as our solvent, and we only get 99% of it back through some recycled process later on that I won't discuss here, that's roughly 5 tons of the stuff lost per day, costing $4,200. Now, the last cost is capital depreciation. So because this thing costs $1.35 million, we can't simply cost that all up front at the start. We need to amortize it over the entire life of the column. And that gives you roughly $100 per day of depreciation costs. Now, if you didn't understand what I was talking about when I was mentioning those activity coefficients, you should check out my first reference here, a brush up with Smith and Van Ness, and then proceed on to my second one, which gives you just a general overview of extractive distillation, divided by semen. That concludes it. Thank you very much for listening.
Good morning, guys. I'm AJ, and my presentation for this topic, as today's presentation, was processes in solid waste management. And the specific unit that I was focusing on was the steam separators, or the Schaumann separators, which belong under the category of steam separators. They're mainly used in municipal solid waste management to separate materials that are found in common households, such as plastic, paper products, and organic waste. These separators are specifically preferred because they can separate particles of different sizes, and unlike other separators, namely magnetic separators, which are really used to separate ferrous and non-ferrous materials most of the time, these can actually separate particles which are much more wider range. And also, one disadvantage of magnetic separators would be they can really separate ferrous and non-ferrous, like I mentioned before, but they cannot be used to separate other materials that are common electronics, such as aluminium and copper. So how this works basically is it takes in the feed from there, and the cylinder is rotated at really high speed, and the final particles fall off from the section. And the medium ones fall there, and the ones that are really big, they actually retain the inside of the cylinder and not outside. The particles that leave from the cylinder, from the pores, is actually known as anhydrous, that's what they call it. and the ones that are retained back over there are called as overs. I did an installation and operation cost, and I thought about that. It costs, depending on the size, it costs around $2,000 to $15,000. And for processing 62.5 tons to 63 tons of municipal solid waste, the capital cost involved was around $890,000 to $892,000. Much more precise, I would say. And when the operating cost was done with an input of around 2,000 tons, with just the shredder, it was around $1.41 per ton. And with the trommel and the shredder, which are huge, like power inch size, it shreds of pockets and the bigger pockets and smaller ones, it was around $1.31 per ton. And the difference came around $109 per ton savings, which is actually not so bad because, plus, considering it, how it is really important in separating materials, it's actually not a lot compared to other separators. And on an annual basis, this gives a return of 6.7% of the incremental capital cost. For more information, I really recommend reading this book, Solid Waste Technology and Management by Christensen. That's actually the most of the information I got from. Thank you very much.
Thank you. selected or what we found out that centrifuges or batch filtration centrifuges are used in the production of sugar. That's the concept that's used to separate out the sugar crystals from the uncrystallized solution, which lost it kind of suspended it. Centrifuges use they work basically by taking a multi density difference. The equation that's used is as all of the and R squared, so it's dependent on the radius of the centrifuge and the speed that it's operated on. So that's basically like what happens and how it's
Right, so we sized it based on what an average plant is producing. An average plant produces about 200,000 tons of sugar crystals per year. We found a relationship between the purity of the acetate entering and the molasses leaving, and based on that we're able to find the yield of sugar crystals, which was then used to find out how much acetate feed we need to reach that production. For us, it was 16 meter cubes per hour. Considering that we're going to operate 360 days a year or 20 hours a day. We designed our centrifuge so that it can operate at 20 meter cubes per hour, and we're going to put two of them. We accounted for this over design just in case of if you want a higher production yield. With that, we were able to determine that the radius for the centrifuge would be about half a meter, height would be 1.4 meters. It would operate at 1220 RPM, and it would have a capacity of 1.1 meter cubes per second. And then we cross-checked it with some references, which showed that bat centrifuge for this operation usually operates between 0.6 and 1, it actually has a radius between 0.6 and 1.2 meters, and our scale did in that, and usually they operate between 1,000 to 1,500 RPM, and once again, our scale between that. Our capital cost was based on the Zonwitz method for two centrifuges of stainless steel, which also required a motor. It was $132,798. Installation was $19,918, and that's the total cost. Operating cost, electricity, it has a power rating of 10.6 kilowatts per centrifuge, and they're operating at 20 hours a day. Based on the price given by the Ontario Energy Board, we were able to determine the cost. Electricity, which was $13,277 per year, and the maintenance was $13,271 per year. Again, that gives us our total cost. These are two good references which we basically use to do everything. One is the handbook of cane sugar engineering, and the second is the transport process and the separation process principles that we have in office. That's it.
Of the oil. Okay, so we did our costing based on 200 tons per day produced, working for 365 days per year. So we actually found an experiment that actually sized it, so we just scaled up from there to find our volume. And the issue was is Don Woods didn't have the shallow bed solvent extraction unit, so we used actually a horizontal vessel and just assumed that our cost would be within the 40% error range. So our capital cost is up there. We also have operating costs for using hexane per year and energy. As you can see there, this is based on 365 days per year. And we also have two great references if you guys want to.
Hi guys, I'm Dan.
you have to be aware of how much energy or how much mechanical stress you're putting on the putting on your product itself, because any sort of degradation or any sort of degradation, when you may have a pure product, it's not going to function the way that you want it to. That's why we landed on liquid-liquid extraction. It takes advantage of the aromatic compound's amphiphilic properties, where it is both soluble in non-polar and polar solvents. This allows us to first extract it with all the non-polar compounds using a non-polar solvent such as hexane, leaving us with just like the wax material covering the glowstone itself with our aromatic compound. And then from there, we isolate it from all those non-polar compounds by dissolving it in a polar solvent such as alcohol. You want to use solvents that have very high volatility so that you don't have to heat up the final product in order to remove any of the solvent, just to avoid thermal degradation.
Okay, for sizing and cost of this kind of process, we determined the suitable process would be have 3% gold production with scale of the year. And so from this, we used a mass balance and a phase diagram you saw on the previous slide to determine the appropriate number of raw material, ethanol, and the carry feed in order to get this production. We used Dongbu correlation to find capital equipment cost, which is basically just a tank with agitation to provide mixing. We determined batch was suitable for this process, since if you look at the previous phase diagram, all of the beta ethanol actually went into the other phase, the ethanol phase. So it's kind of high separation there. And then as for the cost for material, as you can see, the raw fee is most expensive. That's the rose petals that make this beta ethanol. And obviously, that's why these fragrances have a high premium price to them, because they're not cheap to buy or make. And as for the ethanol solvent utilities, that's a really low cost for in the green scheme of things. And after that, we can put down the production compost for a little bit of extraction as well. And I'll put a little extraction reference. That's it.
About the zeolites and how they are. Thank you.
and the roots we need to distribute accelerated. The feed is then fed into rising channels and spread over a large number of physical spaces. The density difference between the pulp and the fluid allows the solid particles to flow to the particle disk. And then those solid particles are slide to the holding space where they're moving spherical. And a clarified liquid with pulp is and the rotation
hardly any kilowatts, which would require a cost of $11,000 per year to operate.
And these other residents, these are your school residents.
Four residents, which is the same, the person is from, just one which is the cheating one, and another one there, and that's, which is the other person.
Another factor is the temperature of the feed water. So the warmer the feed water, the more salt will permeate through the membrane. And this is due to a thermodynamic increase in the salt osmotic pressure. So this means the feed pressure needs to be adjusted to account for the salt permeability, which will increase your operating costs.
Water then undergoes a post-treatment process, which generally consists of a remineralization of the water with carbon dioxide. The pH is then adjusted to approximately 6.8 to 8.1. It then undergoes UV radiation to disinfect anything, followed by water removal. And then the brine is just dumped back into the seawater.
Okay, so we use Perry's handbook for our operating capital costs, and then we scaled it accordingly to our system. So for a flow rate of 24.8 million gallons a day, the capital cost was around $112 million. And the operating cost with 15% downtime annually for maintenance and cleaning was about $20 million a year. And this consists of labor, energy costs, and maintenance costs. So if you want to read about the mass balances, you can see the first source, or if you want to hear more about the energy balances, you can see our second source.
Great, thank you very much, everyone. So, see the law of centrifuges. One of the beautiful about this material is we need to take away some of the interesting aspects of the different separators that we've seen over the past three classes. We'll be looking at that in the exam. Just on the structure of the class next week, we'll have a 10-minute class by Kyle and Chad on supercritical fluid extraction. So they'll be giving an extended talk on their topic and then teaching a bit more about SCFs, supercritical fluid extraction. And then I'll move on to drying, and we'll have a class and a half on that. And then the final class, I'll spend just wrapping up the course on the Friday, because then that's the last class of the term. So I must apologize for the delay in getting the midterms back to you. It's just been brutal overhauling this course while teaching 4M. Both of them for the first time. So it's been a few weeks to get this upgraded, but I finally done it, and so it's time by and pick them up for me now.